The Adventures of Bob Hatson, Casino Project, Chapter 20, Jodie's Innocence. Bob slept alone at Mel's house, and he was very comfortable. His bedroom offers a view on the ocean, with a nice balcony by a sliding door. Jodie was in her own bedroom. During the night, he heard somebody walking in the hallway. Probably Jodie going to bathroom, imagines Bob. I'm going to clear this doubt today, questioning Jodie. Bob stands up out of the bed, a French peignoir on his shoulders, opened the door to go shower. Jodie passing by asks Bob what would he enjoy for breakfast. Bob says that he's not difficult to feed in the morning, simply eggs and fruit if it's possible, an orange juice and a coffee with white bread. Thanks, Jodie. At your service, Sir Hatson, while Bob showers, Mel is already inspired by Bob Hatson's presence in her house. Jodie goes to the kitchen and sees Mel in her office with the phone in her hand. Jodie studies the way Mel acts, preparing her day and making everything possible for Bob to meet, investigate, and reach every destination. She took information to rent a car for Bob. All will be ready for him to concentrate on acquaintances or anyone he wants to meet. Bob, coming down from stairway, says hello to Mel, hearing her hanging up the phone. Miss Blackburn is early at work today.
Oh, yes, sir.
How was your bed, Bob?
Very comfortable, and I had nice dreams under a fantastic moonlight illuminating my bedroom.
You didn't have any problem with my Jodie?
No, Mel. She's been very quiet and no obligations asked from her.
Good, so you'll be in good shape to operate today.
Oh, yes, Mel, indeed. If you need something, you just ask Mel, Bob, and it'll be a pleasure for us to find what you need.
I know, Mel, I know. If I need information, I will call you.
For now, have your breakfast, and we'll talk later, says Mel. Yep, Jodie gives Bob what he needs, nothing less but the best she can.
Oh, serving Sir Hatson is great. I appreciate this moment.
Bob, Bob, call me Bob, please.
That'll be shorter and efficient, Jodie.
Thank you for this nice breakfast.
Wow, we have a beautiful day today, Jodie. Let's see if it will be all the day like this. Maybe after some strange meetings we will change our minds.
What do you mean, Bob?
Well, I didn't come here for nothing, Jodie. I won't waste my time, and I'll meet everyone I want to see today.
I'll have an eye on the town and San Jose's people interested in those condos.
Jodie gave it a little gaze at Bob, meaning where the hell will he go today and who to meet?
Is he referring to the two guys at the restaurant he saw me with?
Now is he investigating me too?
Don't worry, Jodie, I'm just inspecting your reactions. I'm telling you that you won't pass aside without being inspected, you too.
I'm just worrying about you, and I want to know everybody around, so you don't get hurt, lady.
Be assured that I will test everyone I can, examine and investigate on every suspicion.
Don't be surprised by allusions I can make in a day. You'll get used to it.
Oh, Mr. Hatson requires a lot of attention now. Don't worry, Jodie, says Mel. Bob knows what he's doing.
Jodie has breakfast with Bob and enjoy relating facts
about the meeting she had with the two gentlemen in front of the restaurant to clarify Bob's attention.
Jodie is pondering in front of Bob at the table. Bob seems very quiet, and this is for Jodie a disconcerting moment. Bob listens to her very carefully, analyzing every word she says.
In her eyes, Bob seizes her innocence, but trying to clarify every suspicion, where Jodie may put an accent in her talk, where she doesn't have to. Bob feels her escaping from the subject he wants to incorporate in the conversation. Finally, Bob says, "Okay, Jodie, that's enough. Let's take care of the time advantage.
I will investigate on these two gentlemen today and make my opinion.
If I feel worried about you,
I will tell Mel.
If I feel these two gentlemen are threatening you,
I will make them stop."
When Bob Hatson says so, Jodie, "Believe me, those two guys will know him," says Mel.
"At your convenience, Bob, I understand," says Jodie.
The inn of breakfast guides Jodie's hands to Bob's plate, then to Mel's to clean the table. She gave Bob a gentle glance, appreciating how precautions are important for Bob.
"You know me, Miss Blackburn. I just want to be sure that Jodie doesn't run after unnecessary risks," clarifies Bob.
"Absolutely, Bob. I'm with you 100%.
"You kid," Mel insists to Jodie.
"Watch your butt with this man. And don't play fool against him, because you could regret it for the rest of your life."
"Well, I think I will be in complete security with this man," Mel notifies Jodie.
"Just stay on the good side of the fence and you will not have problems, baby. Bob is the greatest man you can meet, but he can be the worst animal for you if you join the bad crowd."
"I think you already know who is the bad crowd around, so don't underestimate Bob Hatson's capacities.
It's quite important for you to understand this man, Jodie, and not only for morality, but for your own security and for the triumph of our goal."
Bob leaves Mel's house around 9 o'clock in the morning. By Mel's information, Bob knows where to find Jodie's clients. And whatever their intention was, Bob wants to clear that up. Arriving at the same restaurant where Jodie met the two gentlemen, Bob, from his rental car, jump out and enter in a restaurant. He wants to be seen and remark so everybody knows he's in town. Once close to the gentlemen at their usual table, Bob addresses a word to the one with the big fuming cigar already smoking before he's at the door to get out. Bob said,
"You could have waited outside to illuminate the sky with your big Cuban cigar."
"To whom do I have the honor to speak and hear what I have to do in my life?" asked he.
"Bob Hatson, sir. And with all my respect that you don't have for others, smoking inside the establishment while people are eating, I would suggest that you come outside with me because I have some words to tell you."
"Oh, oh, oh, I don't want any troubles with you, man."
"Too late, it's already done, man."
Bob opens the door to him and doesn't bend his head at all when he engages in the way out. The other gentleman stayed very quiet, but Bob invites him to do the same as his friends.
"Come on out, you two. I want you to hear the same paragraph," insists Bob.
Once outside, Bob creates a little enigma to put the man under the illusion that they could not buy anything in Costa Rica if they try to impress the gallery bragging that they have plenty of money.
"Oh no, sir, it's not our intention, not at all."
"One more question," asks Bob.
"What's your relation with the girl who was with me yesterday? And you had questions to ask her about condos, she told me."
Well, we want to buy a condo, and as far as we know, she has information which could be interesting for us. We're good players in casino, and we heard we could be safe here in Costa Rica. This is why we approach her, sir.
Fine, retorts Bob. I'm impressed by your loyalty
and pure intentions. I intend to verify your identity. I hope you don't mind.
Not at all, Sir Hatson.
Good. Nice to meet you, gentlemen, and be at home as tourists for now. And in fact, this beautiful woman works with me. Jodie is her name. If you meet Mr. Crombie under any circumstances, tell him that I'm in town for a while.
Okay, sir, we heard about Mr. Crombie, and he's the man we have to do business with.
What kind of business?
Well, about these condos around the casino. Isn't he the owner?
Yes, in fact, he's involved in the whole casino project with partners. And he is Lot's landlord where they build the casino and condos, answered Bob.
My regards to your wives, gentlemen. We'll stay in touch. Bob Hatson doesn't work with a pathetic team.
The reason why he wants to know everybody around is to be sure he's connecting with proper acolytes. Convinced now that Jody's on his side, he calls her and asks to set up a meeting with Mr. Crombie today afternoon or as soon as possible. Jodie calls him back after 5 minutes and confirmed that Mr. Crombie already knew that he was in town. She adds that he can have lunch with him at 1 o'clock at his favorite downtown restaurant. Bob approves. A couple of hours to kill before the meeting. Bob drives to the project site to see how construction is progressing. They're working now on preparing the casino land. The parking lot so heavy machinery can be supported on the field, transporting construction materials. Bob walks inside the fence and has a look on containers stationed to receive and store tools and materials. Bob opens a container door. 5 sealed boxes are standing there. Compelling needs perhaps these boxes, mentions Bob. While he's staring at these, he hears somebody coming. He hides behind a big tool cabinet. 2 construction men enter, and they just throw a quick look at boxes, and one says, "Okay, man, everything's there for tonight. Let's come back in 5 minutes and transfer this material." "Don't lock the door now," the other one says. They are on their way out, and Bob looks at their shoes. Those guys are really not wearing construction boots and clothes, but just a hard hat. "What about everything is there for tonight?" Bob thinks. Once guys are gone, Bob looks at boxes again. He sees duct tape on the shelf. Opening one box, white powder in transparent plastic bags appears right in his face. Astonished. "There you go, Bob, a little jackpot right here." Bob seals back with duct tape. "Now let's go and see Mr. Crombie and enjoy lunch." Bob presumes he'll have a long night. Driving his car, he gives a call to Miss Blackburn and tell her that he won't be there for supper.
Mel asks him,
"What is it, Bob? Did you find something?"
"Nothing incriminating for now, Mel. See you later at night." Bob stayed discreet on this one. Slipping out some words could interrupt the operation they have to do tonight. Bob arrives at the restaurant for Crombie's meeting. He parks the car. Who is there? The gorgeous girl from Mel's house. Jodie is running to her car. Bob approaches Jodie's car. Hey, Jodie, what are you doing here?
Hello, Bob, with a radiant smiling face. I brought some papers for Mr. Crumby, and he told me you're going to meet him for lunch.
What kind of papers?
Papers for a gentleman you met this morning. They finally are buying a condo from Crumby,
so they called,
and asked me to prepare the demand for buying their condo, and wanted to be one of the first on buyer's list.
Bob frowns and say, Are you all right with these guys, Jodie? Or are you sure there's no problem with them?
No dismal failure between us, Jodie.
Just warning you, says Bob.
Bob, don't worry. I'm on the good side and I intend to stay with you.
Bob calls Mel and asks about this.
Mel is assertive. Jodie is and will always be working with her. So she reassures Bob.
She too has to make money, Bob, she says. So if she finds clients for Crumby, it's a part of her job and Crumby pays well.
Okay, Mel, I understand. But I would prefer she doesn't stay too close to Crumby from now on because I already found something that could introduce her in a bad sequence.
We will talk about this later.
Bob is received at the table as these gentlemen had known each other since they were born.
Don't be too gentle, Mr. Crumby, with me. You know that I'm not here to give you gifts.
I know, Sir Hatson, and that's why I just want to be sure you don't misjudge us in Costa Rica. I wanted to tell you that, in fact, policemen are on our side in this country. Everyone here wants this project realized. I'm offering you this launch with me as a brilliant moment under special circumstance. To our casino project.
Cheers!
Bob lift up his glass and add,
To the respect of this country and hope outer culprits stay away.
Two gentlemen from the cartel are with them at the table, and they do not look like school kids. One of them asked Bob why he's in Costa Rica. Bob said,
Because I want you to know that my best friend in Canada died, maybe because of this project.
Well, I would say not because of the project itself, but by some men who wanted to succeed at any price
by using violent acts.
Now they have put his wife in a very sad situation. She's hurt because she lost what was most important to her. Bob adds, This man was the closest friend I had and a very good help for transport in Canada and U.S. Now I intend to solve this problem and I will use all my resources to reach out to these criminals.
I will do all I can, just like you do for your project.
I'll sustain public opinion and make them know that there is not only money in our lives, but human race. And you may count on me to find out the truth about my friend's accident. I already have all information. I will adjust within time, evidence, criminals, and will prove that a project is not only a project, but you have to realize it with respect for our folks and with integrity. And I suggest that you don't walk over Jody's innocence.